Yeah. So right now you should be seeing a welcome to getting to know Great Lakes FieldScope part two. And I'm just going to talk a little bit about what to expect today. Oh, and some logistics before we go into that. So everybody's muted just by default. If you have any questions or if you'd like to make a comment, either raise your hand or send a little note in the chat box and I will go and unmute you as it's appropriate. And feel free to ask questions throughout. I'm a little concerned when everybody's muted that it kind of shuts down conversation. We do want to interact and have some feedback from you guys. So please don't be shy about raising your hand or letting me know if you have a comment that you'd like to add. So yes, that's the first thing. The second thing is we're going to have a few polls throughout. So hopefully you'll participate. It looks like we had some pretty good participation in that first one there. Also, we're going to have, okay, so you can see what to expect today is we're going to have an overview of part one and the poll results, and Elizabeth's going to kick that off for us. She's our Director of Communications and Education Services here at Michigan Sea Grant. We're going to have a little review of the homework session. So for those of you who said homework, what homework? Hopefully that will kind of shed some light on it. And for those of you who did it, you'll be able to share some of your experiences, hopefully. We're going to have a couple of testimonials from those who went through it. Elena and Brandon, if there's time, are going to discuss how people are using the tools, particularly from a teacher standpoint. We're going to have some questions and comments throughout different periods of time. Elena Takaki with National Geographic is going to discuss some of the tools, the next steps, things like that. Now that you're familiar with it, what do you do with it? Elizabeth's going to cover some professional development opportunities. We're going to do another question and answer period there. So if you have any remaining questions or other things, just let us know. Let's see. And then we'll do a little bit of a wrap up. So just so you guys know, today is being recorded and we will convert this into a video and it'll be available in the coming days. And just as a brief overview, the undercurrent or the theme for what we're doing today for part two is now that we know about this and we've tried it out and we've tested things, what do we do with it? So keep that in mind. That's the context of which we're approaching this. And without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Elizabeth Laporte. Like I said, she's Director of Communications and Education Services from Michigan Sea Grant here in Ann Arbor. And she's going to be doing our overview and the summary of our polls from part one. So just unmuting Elizabeth.
Hi, everyone, and thanks for joining us for part two. We're really excited about this tool. And for those of you that couldn't join us for part one, don't worry. You know, we're glad that you're here today. And we'll try to give you just a quick review of what we did. So we basically provided everyone with information about the FieldScope tools. And Elena knows the FieldScope tools like the back of her hand, and so I'm hoping that the rest of us will get to that point as well. And so today she's going to be going a little more in depth with a couple of tools in particular that, so it won't be repetitive for those of you that were able to join us for part one. And then my colleague Brandon Schroeder in Northeast Michigan gave us a really good example of how teachers have used FieldScope in his neck of the woods, and it particularly in relationship to the Great Lakes Stewardship Initiative. So those of you in other states that are involved in that as well, one of the things we want to do is to try to, view FieldScope as a tool that you can apply to other grant initiatives, other projects, that sort of thing. And then we provided you with access to resources, and one of those resources is the online curriculum that Michigan Sea Grant developed in collaboration with others around the region. It was supported by the Great Lakes Observing System, And that's called Teaching Great Lakes Science. And so what we feel is that it's a great way for teachers, if they're not sure about water quality subject matter, to go and to tap into the material that's there in the lessons and activities. There are also static data sets there in the form of Excel spreadsheets. And there's a link to that curriculum from the Great Lakes FieldScope website. And so then the homework assignment. So the idea was that, you know, it wasn't real complex. The whole concept was to get folks to become familiar with the tools, to create their own account, to do some specific things in terms of, you know, really exploring FieldScope as a tool and adding data and using some of the other tools. And so the additional resource that we provided was the introductory guide for Great Lakes FieldScope. We borrowed very heavily from the Chesapeake folks and from material that National Geographic created in developing a Great Lakes-specific guide with some Great Lakes-specific examples. And so then, in addition to that, there is the recorded webinar for part one. And so you can get to all that information, and Stephanie's going to put up some web URLs and other things, not necessarily now, although, but at the end of the webinar, so that if you don't know how to get to that material, we'll send that information to you. So, again, the whole idea was to explore FieldScope, and so we know that a number of people actually did that, and what we have are basically some user or participant testimonials from several people, and so we want to be able to get to that information. And so the other thing was that we really took the poll information that you provided us seriously, that you know, you had a lot of interest in using the tool, but you weren't sure how it works. So that's why we sort of went through methodically having Elena demonstrate the tools, you know, how to sign in an account, how to really get started with this, and then, as I said, we'll dive in deeper with a couple of the tools today and provide you with more information, and then also just again point to the references, including the guide that, you know, provides you with the step-by-step and some examples of what you could do for homework. And so I'd like to then turn it over to the folks that would be providing some of the testimonials. So are we ready for that? That's our... Okay.
All right. Yeah, it was just showing a little bit of the poll results there. We're on screen. Hopefully you guys had a chance to take those in while Elizabeth was talking. Here's just a little bit of a review of that homework assignment. So as we enter into the next section here with our testimonials. So Tim McDonald, you were our fearless volunteer. Are you ready? Actually, it looks like I need to just send Tim the audio pin real quick here. I think something was amiss with him getting online here. So, well, let me... We'll go on to our next person then. So Daniel Moffitt is coordinator for the Northeast Michigan Great Lakes Stewardship Initiative. He also volunteered, I think, at the coercion of Brandon. But let me unmute Dan. Dan, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. So we asked you guys a couple of questions. I'm just going to review them, and then you can kind of give us your impression of how it was going through FieldScope. So the questions that we asked of everybody and wanted to focus on today, but also wanted to dive a little deeper, was so what tasks did you perform? What tools did you use? What did you like about FieldScope? And what didn't you like about your experience using FieldScope thus far? So if you want to take it from there, Dan, go ahead.
Thank you. So what I did, I didn't do any data entry, but what I chose to do was something that I think could be a useful tool for FieldScope. What I did was create a map that I think could be shared with teachers or partners or put into a report or link to a website with the create image file or option. And then so with that, the tools that I used were the drawing tools on the left side, polygon freeform labeling tools, and the linking tool. And then, of course, the query polygon helped me find out the area of those pieces that I was doing. And I guess I could back up and just kind of a background. There's a school that we work with that's doing management of an invasive species and buckthorn. And so you see on the screen there the school to the left and then the outdoor education site. So I was able to go on and outline the education site, outline the different years. You see 2012 and 2013 are years that they went and did some management. They removed buckthorn, they did some herbicide application, and so this tool allowed me to go in there, label that, query the area, and then query total site area so that I could start to figure out, you know, percentages of, and impact of what the classes were doing there outside of their school. Should I go right just into what I liked and what I didn't?
Yeah, go right ahead.
Okay, so what I liked about it was the ease of navigating those drawing tools once I started to become familiar with them. I liked the color options, the transparency options that I had to indicate what it was that, you know, I was trying to communicate through that map. And like I mentioned, those query tools, the polygon and also the query point, allows you to, you know, get some other information like your elevation or your watershed. What I didn't like about it, I found some quirks. I felt like the labeling option was a little bit limited. You can only type in one line, so you can't hit the enter button to make like a larger label. So you can see the Thunder Bay Outdoor Education site is separate from Buckthorn Management. And then when I wanted to link a web page, in this case, which would be the students or the class profile page on our website, I'd have to link either to each one of those labels or just choose one. When you zoom in and change, so if you're on FieldScope website, when you zoom in, the labeling size changes with the zoom in. So it can get a little bit confusing. And also the units of square kilometers, it's a hard unit to grasp, I think, for maybe some students if you don't work with those units very well or very often. And I think that about does it.
Okay. Yeah, great feedback. Now, Dan, can you talk maybe, I know you work with quite a few teachers in the field, in the classroom. How do you see them using this?
Are you specifically about the mapping feature or just FieldScope in general?
FieldScope in general, or if you had comments on both, that's fine.
Sure. Well, I guess in this case, with pulling off a map and be able to take an image of this site, it could be very helpful for my teacher who's working at this school, you know, for doing some planning and kind of just getting that perspective of above the ground. It's like jumping in an airplane and be able to see kind of flow paths and where water's coming from and the different body of waters it moves through. So I think largely FieldScope is just that visualization, even without data or data input, it's a huge resource. I know you can do, you know, there's other options out there like Google Maps and Google Earth, but this one too, because we do have so many teachers who are working with data collection, whether it be macroinvertebrates or water quality or invasive species, I think it's one tool that can tie both of those elements together.
Yeah, that's great. That's how we envision it being used, so very nice. Were there any other comments that you wanted to make about it or any questions you might have?
One thing, I did a query point for the watershed, right at that outdoor education site near the school. And because we're in Alpena, we're very close to Lake Huron, so we're kind of in, unless you're right in the river valley, we're what they call like a coastal watershed, right? So I did a query point for watershed, and what it was labeled as was Lone Lake and Akiak, which was a little bit confusing. I don't know if it was mislabeled. It should be Long Lake, which is a lake near here, and Akiak is a river that's north of here a while, but that was one thing that I thought it might be confusing to users or teachers that say, well, we're telling them they're in the Thunder Bay River watershed, and here I click this, and it says Lone Lake Akiak. It was something that stuck out to me a little bit.
Mm-hmm. And I, you know, we've addressed a little bit of that. And Alina, I unmuted you, thinking you might want to comment on that.
Yeah, those labels come from USGS. And certainly there are errors in the data that's there. And I think that's the importance of ground truthing the data. You know, any kind of satellite image that you're looking at is a computer interpretation of what's really going on. And by the time the satellite data gets published, new neighborhoods are built, new roads are constructed, and when you go and you look at that satellite data on your particular map using your particular program, that information could have changed. So that's, and human error occurs. So, you know, Long Lake or Lone Lake sounds like there's a typo there. So the ground truthing is really important. And that's why field experiences for students is so important as well.
Great. Thank you for that, Alina. And it looks like our next testimonial is, he was having a little bit of trouble getting on. I think the software was kicking him out. But hopefully, I think we're ready here with Timothy McDonald. And let me go back to my slide set real quick here. So Tim is the coordinator of the New York Geographic Alliance. Tim, can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Okay, and we can hear you. Yay! Yeah, do you want to talk a little bit about your experience with FieldScope? And one of the things that I think is great about how you've used FieldScope, Tim, is that you've used it for both the Chesapeake Bay, since you're in New York, you have both the ocean perspective and the Great Lakes perspective. So if you can talk a little bit about those questions, but also your unique point of view would be much appreciated. So go right ahead.
Okay, well, yeah, we do. We have the headwaters of the Susquehanna River in New York State. And, of course, we also are part of the Great Lakes system because we have shorelines on both Lake Erie and Lake Ontario. So originally I got involved, and so did the New York Geographic Alliance, through the Chesapeake Bay Watershed Initiative that Elena is running. And then since then, FieldScope has been expanded. I think it includes the Delaware watershed now, and of course now the Great Lakes. So I've been trying to learn the little, the idiosyncrasies of all three of them, because we have all three of those watersheds in our state. So what I'm trying to do now is try to find some common themes that we can use to do workshops in all parts of the state. That's really helping our numbers, getting more people to come to the workshops. I'm particularly interested, because since I'm in Rochester, New York, I'm particularly interested in the health of the Great Lakes system itself. But from a state perspective, I'm also interested in how it affects the Chesapeake Bay watershed, too. So we're trying to get more and more people to do water testing around the state. My colleague, Stephen Vermette from Buffalo State College, has developed some water testing kits that are very easy for students to use. So our next step now is, now that we can get this in the hands of teachers, we're hoping that they will start posting data on one of the three different field scopes, and so we can get a much better picture of what's going on in our part of the country. I don't know, what else do you want to know?
Maybe just talk about some of the features that you really like about FieldScope, in addition to what you addressed there.
What I really like about it is, the fact that it's so easy to use is probably the first thing. And I think students can pick it up pretty quickly. I particularly like the watershed feature, where you can see what watersheds you're in, and then you can do a query about the watershed to see what kind of land cover is in that area. One of the features, I don't know if this feature's on the Chesapeake one, but I know it is on the Great Lakes. I like the one where you can plot the areas of concern, because I think that helps tie in what you're doing to when the students go out in the field. They can see, well, this is an area we're worried about. And for example, in the Rochester area, the part of Lake Ontario known as the Rochester Embayment is a major area of concern because of all the pollution that comes in from the factories of that part of the state. So the only thing is, though, I'm assuming that most of the pollution is not testable with the kits that we've got. It's probably things like Myrex or dioxins or something like that. And then what's the other feature? I also like the flow feature, because I think it's important for students to be able to see where their water is going to what they're connected with. And so I think that's a very powerful tool as well. And that's all I can think of at the point at the moment.
Oh, that's great. And in fact, I think Elena is going to talk a little bit more about some of those particular tools further on. Okay. Did you have anything you wanted to add or any questions that you wanted to put out there?
Well, I just wanted to point out, if people are interested, I did post some data from a stream near Rochester in Webster, New York. So if they wanted to, you know, check that one out, it's there.
Okay.
And but, you know, just so, well, I'm going to try to get some more data, because I know I think it would be especially interesting to those people in Michigan or Ohio to see, you know, how our water quality compares to yours. Because we are the inheritors of what comes, you know, from your direction. But we are adding, I think, our own contributions to the degradation of the lakes. I'm sorry, in some cases.
Yeah, you said that very eloquently. It sounded almost nice. Yes.
Well, I'm trying to be politically correct.
Yes, which is appreciated. Yes. Well, thank you for your input on that. And, you know, feel free to chime in. And
okay.
So I'm going to move over to our next person then, who is Kristen. And I know, Kristen, I'm going to say your last name wrong. I always say Tapas, but I have a feeling it's pronounced slightly different than that. So you are now unmuted. Can you hear us?
Sure. Yeah. Thanks, Stephanie. It's T-Pos. You are close. You are very close. So I played around a lot with it actually today, a little late. The only thing I didn't do is the camera. And I really like what other people have already said, that just the ease of use, it's pretty intuitive. The drawing tools were great, and the ability to save the maps, both as a file as well as pulling it back up on the site and then you can edit. I really liked that, and just the ability to toggle around was really easy. I think some of the parts that I should back up and explain what my interest for the site would be. I work for Illinois Indiana Sea Grant as a liaison in US EPA's Great Lakes National Program Office. And we have a joint program where we loan out their hydro labs, so their data sound monitoring equipment, and there's 7 sensors on this particular piece of equipment. So it can monitor depth, temperature, conductivity, oxygen, chlorophyll A, turbidity, and pH. And so I was starting to develop a site where the teachers, we loan this out to teachers, where they could upload their data, and this site is much more robust than, you know, what I would be able to do. So I'm very interested in perhaps using this site instead. But I guess some of the things that seem like barriers, and I guess I'm wondering how much wiggle room we have, is the ability to search So if we have a group of teachers that are borrowing this equipment, can we find them on the map? Is there a way, you know, when you put the search in and you do it by location, could you do it by a group name or some other way? So that, I guess, would be one thing that I didn't like about it, that I'm wondering if it's possible to, as opposed to just looking at the dots on the map, if there's a way to identify people within your subgroup, your sub-program. And then also, is it possible to add other parameters to that list? I think the only one that wasn't available was chlorophyll A. And then kind of in line with the parameters, some of the teachers will go to lakes that, and take do a depth profile. So they'll take multiple measurements at different depths. And it didn't seem like that spreadsheet, I'm not sure quite how they would do that. So if there was, you know, a way to alter, I guess, the parameter spreadsheet. And then I think my last question would be about how is it possible to interact with other users? So say you see another site, another school that's collecting something, could you click on that station and get contact information so that you could connect with them just directly? So I really liked it. I'm just wondering if, you know, some of the things I didn't like about it, if there's, you know, room to make changes.
Right. And I think some of the questions that you had, Kristen, are we've been seeing in we've been getting some emails and some contact that are somewhat similar to the questions that you have. So I think Alina and Elizabeth will be able to address those in a little while here.
Okay.
So
I think one other thing, just as I'm in Chicago, and so these maps are for the Great Lakes Basin. So we have a very skimpy shoreline or watershed if you're really looking truly at the Great Lakes Basin in Illinois. And I wasn't sure if there was any room for getting at least the Great Lakes states fully with the layers, like the land use layer. Or if it's just going to stay within the Great Lakes watershed, which I would understand. And I'm not sure. I when I was playing with the flow path, I often got 0 kilometers. It just didn't go anywhere. And I wasn't sure if that was something that, you know, happens often or if it's related to the layers, you know, what the locations that I was looking at.
Hi, Kristen. Elizabeth.
Hi, Elizabeth.
Thanks for giving it a good test drive. And yes, as Elena said earlier, we're still working out some of the, you know, issues, and which is why, you know, we want people to use it, and the more people use it, then the more feedback that we can get. You know, addressing, you know, including some additional parameters, we have talked about that, and actually Brandon brought it up and other people, you know, how we might be able to do that. So we're collecting information, you know, about what people would like to add. So if you wouldn't mind just, you know, sending me an email, that would be great. And then I can, you know, collect some of that I already have in terms of requests to add other things. And then we can approach Elena and the others at National Geographic and see, you know, what else we can do to add different things. But, you know, as far as the basin boundaries, we're at this point sticking with that just because we got the initial GIS layers from USGS.
Yep.
And those were kind of the parameters that we gave them. So we sort of started out with actually a paper-based map of the Great Lakes Basin that was based on the GIS layers that USGS was able to get.
Mm-hmm.
And then we just went back to them and said, can you sort of reconfigure this so that we could have, you know, create Great Lakes FieldScope in this kind of more dynamic way. You know, there may be other ways that we can work with you to try to, you know, include more, you know, information you know, about the state of Illinois or the state of Indiana.
Yeah.
So there may be other tools we could develop collaboratively.
Okay.
Is that helpful?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, great. That's really great feedback too. I mean, just from all of you guys, because you're using it in very similar ways, but also calling out different things that you liked and that you didn't like so much. So it's, I think, good to have all different types of perspectives there. So is there anybody else who would like to share their experience doing their homework or kind of going through FieldScope and what they liked about it, what tools you used, how you could foresee using this in your classroom, or how you may have already used it in your class or out in the field somewhere? If you want to go ahead and raise your hand or send something to the chat or question box, that'd be fine. In the meantime, Elena, did you want to talk a little bit about some of the teacher testimonial or some of the ways that teachers you've been interacting with have been using it?
Sure. Sure. Can you share my screen?
Yes. Sorry, it's just taking a sec here to find you in the list. There we go. You should have it.
Okie doke. All right. Can everyone see my screen?
Yes.
Bridging indoor and outdoor learning with FieldScope.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, you know, one of the main goals of FieldScope, and I say this every time I present because I want to make sure that people understand one of National Geographic's main goals is that students get outside and have a rich field experience, an extended experience, in this case with water quality. So the goal is not for kids to sit inside and look at a computer all day. The goal is for them to connect what they're doing outside to learning standards, make STEM connections and Common Core connections, and meet important learning standards and teaching goals and objectives in context of this field experience that they're having. So that's definitely one of our major goals. Right now, we have a massive open online course, or a MOOC, going on in the Chesapeake Bay region, and they are using FieldScope, very similar to the project that the Great Lakes is based off of. And so what you're seeing on the screen now is just some of the few thoughts that teachers have had that I pulled out. This is based on their evaluation so far of FieldScope. And so, I pulled out some quotes, not just specific to FieldScope, but mapping in general. The first quote talks about FieldScope, and I liked that particular quote because it talks about the connectedness of a geographic system. So, in science, and we deal a lot with science teachers, we're so focused on, you know, this content of science that sometimes we forget to pull back and look at how science is influenced by geography. And that's really where the cross-curricular connections happen, right, is with your social studies and with your science. And, I think that's one of the real powerful components, not just of FieldScope, but of GIS in particular. I often do workshops, and all the science teachers like to say, oh no, GIS belongs in science. And all the social studies teachers say, no, it's a geographic information system. It belongs to social studies. So they like to fight over who gets GIS. And I say, well, why can't you? Well, you can both have GIS. It's good. It's fine. You can share that. And the second quote I have there is, you know, mapping is an important skill, one that I haven't thought of incorporating into my biology classes. So again, you know, teachers tend to be really focused on these particular content things, but then pulling back and looking and seeing how the geography can influence particular types of content, such as, you know, biology. And I really like that quote because now this teacher is looking at his or her content in a new context. That's exciting for the teacher. It's something new for them, and it's stretching their thinking. And if it's stretching their thinking, you know, it's stretching the student's thinking. So, and I think that's really one of the things that we're encouraging here. The third quote that I pulled out from teacher feedback is just about mapping in general and how using maps helps to create a sense of place. So, you know, this teacher said that interacting with your surroundings on a more personal level is a valuable way to connect with your environment. And without that connection, the place loses value and personal importance. And I think that's, you know, I really wanted to pull that quote out because students have a hard time understanding where they are. You know, the world is a very big place to a young person who probably hasn't traveled very much. So having them understand where they are, why the geography of where they live is that way, understanding the historical and geological and geographical context of where they live, why is this particular tree here in my neighborhood? Why are these frogs found here but not 10 miles down the road? Why do these birds come and feed on this shoreline but not another shoreline? I think those are important questions to ask that are all related to geospatial understanding and again, understanding where they live and connecting them to where they are. So those are just some of the types of quotes that we've received feedback for. Other teachers have echoed some of the challenges that we've heard so far today in that, okay, well, you know, we have this mapping thing, now what? What do I do in my classroom to make this happen? Give me some activities, give me some lessons, help me tie it back to my curriculum and make those curricular connections. And that's something we're definitely working with a lot of different partners to do on an individual state and even LEA basis.
Great, thank you. Well, stay tuned for that then. If somebody did want to work with you on some of these things, what do they do? Should they go through Sea Grant or?
You mean in developing an activity?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think probably the best thing to do, what I would do is connect them with a local partner. You know, at National Geographic being a national and international organization, we don't really have the capacity to develop very specific lessons. We develop very general ones. We would probably direct them back to a local partner.
Okay.
To work with them on that.
Okay. Yeah. So if you guys have questions, you can email Michigan Sea Grant and we'll work with you on it. We did have one question come in from Jerry Rising. And we kind of talked about this a little bit already. Jerry says, my main concern is watersheds and the flow direction. I found problems with these tools for my region, and I wonder if there are ways to communicate or make corrections. So, typically we say, send us the information and we'll see what we can do with it. We'll work with Elena and the developers to see if we can get that corrected. So,
yeah, and I think we talked about this a little bit in the first webinar. Mm-hmm. If you're in Lansing, there's definitely an issue there. So with the flow path tool, the way that works is underlying the flow path tool is an elevation data layer. So that elevation data layer, I forget where we got it from, probably USGS. And so the flow path kind of calculates the flow path on the fly, depending on where you click. And it's going to go from higher to lower numbers, right, based on the watershed that's there. So again, the importance of ground truthing and looking at where that data comes from and the resolution of that data. So also, sometimes there are gaps in data, and I think that's what happened in the Lansing area, was that we just didn't have some data for part of Lansing. Like, it just, for whatever reason, was not mapped. The elevation was not mapped. So when FieldScope is trying to calculate the flow path when it's trying to delineate a watershed on the fly, it does some very quirky and wonky things. And also sometimes if you look at the satellite data layer and you do something like try to delineate a watershed, you'll see that the watershed delineation crosses a river. And you think, oh, wait, that's not right. It's not supposed to cross a river. Well, again, there's some discrepancy between the resolution of the data. So the satellite data might be a much higher resolution than the elevation data layer, for example. And that's why you see some discrepancies like that. I think it's a good way, it's a lesson to talk to about students. Maybe if they're in high school, they might understand that there are different resolutions of data, different the granularity of the data is different, and so when you try and match up those two, it doesn't quite match up perfectly.
Yeah, and we talked a little bit before about the importance of then getting out into the field and saying, okay, so is this accurate, is this not accurate, and
right.
Turning that really into a teachable moment.
Right.
So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Jefferson Henry, who was volunteering to talk about his experience as well. So Jefferson, can you hear us?
Yes, I can. Can you hear me?
I think you need to mute your speakers. Yeah, is that better?
Okay, let me mute my speakers here. Am I still echoing?
Nope. Sounds like you're okay.
Okay. Well, I'm not a teacher, but this was very intriguing with some professional uses, but certainly would pass over into educational uses with the elevations that's available and to follow a water table. You pour out a glass of water, or if you're pumping 200 or 2 million gallons a day, into a stream, for instance, to be able to tell where that is taking place and where what it's connecting to is quite a tool. From a classroom standpoint, you could visit, people could visit with their students to a wastewater treatment plant or to a water treatment for drinking water, because this is, after all, a clean water tool. That was a lot of the playing around that I did with it, was to see where some of the water was traveling, and was able to have some high capacity areas that I could use. I think also there should be some other points in West Michigan that shares this information, or that people can understand about West Michigan. About the tools, I'm pretty familiar with those tools from other software, and I think that as class rooms age, that they're going to run into these in a PowerPoint or a paperport or some other type of application. So I thought they were user friendly. Certainly, there's some glitches in it, but with the credibility that you have, and then there actually was able to do some field measurements that, you know, as close as you could get and expect, you know, could very much be within a foot. Argument could be made that's how accurate it was for this location. I guess the only question I would have is how does, for example, geological survey and National Geographic feel about an accuracy that to give it quite a help with that question is in an area that we were watching that discharges 2.5 million gallons a day with changing about a foot and using longitude latitude, you see a dramatic change, and I think that's an important issue.
Well, yeah, let's I'm not sure that we have quite an answer for that yet. I mean, Elena, if you wanted to handle that, let me go in here. I think we've addressed some of the inaccuracy in talking about how we're trying to move forward and improve things. But, you know, we're using the data that's available. So is there anything you wanted to add there?
So are you asking for higher resolution data in a particular area?
Sorry, hang on a sec. Jefferson, did you catch that question?
Yes. Well, actually, I felt that there was a high degree of accuracy from what we were mapping distance and such. I just was the accuracy also seemed to be with the elevations that, so understanding that the flow of water could change, you know, certainly within a foot, because the change does take place when the water's flowing one way and it flows another way, if it's the same, it's the same body, or if it's from a discharge. So all I was basically saying, asking is, in such a case like that, there should be, it must be a lot of confidence. We found a lot of accuracy with it. I just kind of like, how do you feel about the accuracy of something like that? How do you,
great.
I mean, I don't think it's a bug. I think it's like, do you feel that confident about it?
Okay. Yeah. Well, yes. Yeah. Thanks for the question. And Elena, did you want to talk a little bit more about that, or does that kind of cover it?
No, I think that's great. Thank you.
Yeah, it's nice to hear. And we had another comment come in here from Kathleen Doherty, who had to take off. But she just said, thank you for taking the time to make this educational webinar possible. And she's trying to get teachers conducting water quality studies at the parks to use this tool, too. So she sees a lot of value in it in that way. And now kind of moving on from the comments, unless anybody else had a question or wanted to mention something, not seeing anything here. So without barring anything else, any other questions coming in, Elena, if you wanted to talk about some of the next steps, now that we're familiar with the tool, what do we do with it? What do we do next? And then also some of the future ideas for FieldScope that are coming up soon. And I can share the desktop as well. So if you had some things you wanted to show. Yep, sorry, I hope I didn't transfer that too early for you. And Elena, it looks like you're still muted on your side of things.
Sorry, there we go.
That's okay.
I just told you the meaning of life, by the way.
Oh my gosh, okay. I knew it. I knew it. Thank you.
As was mentioned in earlier comments, the flow path tool is really one of the most popular tools that we have. And I think it's the reason it's so popular is because it helps make that connection for students to where they are in the watershed. So they might be somewhere, like in the example you see, somewhere around Farmington Hills, but you know, what is their connection to this flow path? If they were to pour that glass of water, it's 364 kilometers away. That's a pretty far away for students. So getting them to really make that connection. One of the examples that I've seen a lot of teachers like to do with that flow path tool, for example, would be to move things around on my screen a little bit. They could use land cover. So they'd turn on the land cover layer, and then they'd use the flow path tool. And one of the things the students would have to do would be to create a story. So now you have a common core connection here. You could work with your ELA teacher. Students can create a story about how that drop of water flows through these different landscapes here. What is the student going to see? And they can change the layers too if they want to look at the street data, or if they want to look at satellite data, and they can use the land cover data as well to help them create their story for that flow path. Another thing I've seen teachers do with the flow path tool is they have turned on the watershed boundaries. And the example I gave right there was not a good example, but for example, if the flow path were to go through different watersheds, that students would have to name the different watersheds. So let me show that example there. So let me click on this one. Oh, that was a good one because it looks like it goes through several different watersheds. So because I have the watershed boundaries layer turned on, I can query that particular layer. So it tells me that where I clicked was open grassland, but the watershed boundary, it's in the pine watershed, according to that. So then students can also create a story about all the different types of watersheds that their drop of water would go through in order to get to its outpour path. So those are a couple of activities I've had I've heard that teachers are doing in the classroom. Another one, and I think I mentioned this last time but didn't go into too much detail, it's my favorite thing to do really with FieldScope is this query a polygon layer. So I'm going to turn off watershed boundaries, and you can see that I have land cover checked. So I'm going to I'm going to compute a watershed first, and I'm going to click on my location, and you can see it's created a little watershed there. I'm going to get rid of the other one, and I will zoom in so we can see that watershed a little bit better. And one of the things you can do, so say let's pretend that's a park where your students are going out to collect water quality data. And now what you can do is you can query that polygon. It's going to ask me, do I want to draw a new polygon or do I want to use the existing one? And I'm going to say, use the existing polygon. And again, because I have the land cover layer turned on, it's going to tell me what the land cover is like in that particular polygon. So before I take my students out, we can make a prediction. What do we think we're going to see when we get to that park or when we get to our location to do our water quality studies? What, based on this, what do we expect the water quality to be like in that particular watershed? So they're making these predictions, then they're going to go out and test the water quality, and then they're going to go back to their predictions and talk about how accurate their predictions were and explain why their predictions were correct or not. So you ask kids to draw a conclusion based on evidence, and again, using that pre-knowledge before they go out. That's always been one of my favorite activities with FieldScope. I really like that one because that way you're getting students to start thinking about their location before they actually go out there. Again, another neat thing you can do is change the base layer to satellite data, and they can get a really nice look at what their area is like. Do that really quick here. And you can zoom in pretty nice. You can get a pretty high resolution here for the layers. You can make the land cover layer a little more transparent so you can see. So they can play with these types of tools to justify their prediction. Why do they think the water quality will be really good? Well, it's because they looked up, you know, their park area, and it's a lot of deciduous forest in that particular area, so they would expect the water quality to be pretty good. So they're justifying their predictions, and then they're justifying their conclusions at the end. So those are two of my favorite activities when it comes to FieldScope. And, you know, teachers do a lot of other interesting activities too. Some of which we'll start publishing as well. One of the things I wanted to share with you is where FieldScope is going in the future. And one of the exciting things is we have just built a data collection app, and I'll show you some images from that. It's right now, it's in the pilot stage, and we'll probably have the app available in the App Store. It's for iPhone 4 and 5 and the iPad. And we'll probably have it in the store by March. Another exciting thing that we have coming out is our Project Builder tool. And that is where if you have some sort of GIS capability, you'll be able to build your own project. So say, for example, you really want to focus on tree canopy in Grand Rapids. You can upload the data layer for Grand Rapids. Maybe you'd want the street layer up there. And then you can have your citizen scientists go out and map where all the trees are in Grand Rapids. So you'll be able to build a project that's very specific to your area. I think someone mentioned Chicago. And one of the complications that we've had in organizing these projects around watersheds is that watersheds don't know political boundaries. And we've had the same issue come up in the Chesapeake Bay region where, you know, not all of New York is in the Chesapeake Bay watershed. So how do we involve the whole state? Because as a state educator, my goal is to educate all the students about a particular topic, not just ones in a particular watershed. So the complication arises because you could keep adding watersheds and you could keep building, keep adding states onto each project, and it would never end until we have the entire continental U.S. covered. And then it wouldn't be the Great Lakes Project anymore. So hopefully in the middle of next year, you will be able to build your own FieldScope project. We're very excited about that. Also, we have a new version of FieldScope coming up, and I'll show you a couple of quick images about that in just a second. Here is how the FieldScope app will look like on the iPhone. Right now, it's optimized for FieldScope 5, but I have, or FieldScope, it's optimized for the iPhone 5, but I have the iPhone 4, and it works pretty well. It's just the screen doesn't all fit on there. There's a couple of more screenshots about how it looks on the iPhone. So you can be out in the field and you can collect your water quality data and you'll be able to enter the data here and upload it to FieldScope through this app. And here's an example of what it looks like on the iPad. And you can see you can add an observation, you can view or edit your observations, or you can add a new location if you're out in the field collecting data. So we're very excited about that. We'll keep you appraised of the progress on the app development, but again, we hope to have it fully available by March of next year. Before I say thank you, I want to show you really quick the new version of FieldScope. Here's an example of how FieldScope will look for the Great Lakes in the next year or two, and we'll work with Sea Grant about when's the appropriate time to roll it out. But you can see that when you come to the project, and it'll be greatlakes.fieldscope.org, you've got basically four choices. You could either map data, you can enter data, or you could graph data. And so what the new version has is a lot of scaffolds that helps you get through each of the steps along the way. One of the really nice things is we have these starter maps already created. So if you want your students to look at dissolved oxygen, there are these maps that are already created. As a teacher, maybe you want to focus just on your particular area. If your area is Ann Arbor, you can create your own map. So here, I have my own saved map. I created a map on stream health. So you can have your students look at your maps. And you can see here are some maps that have been published already. So you can have your students go look for your map, and they can already start there as opposed to having them start from the very beginning. So, and your map could be very focused on a particular topic. So we're very excited about that. When you decide to create your own map, you'll see that it walks you through the steps of how to create that map. So the first thing, you have to select a base map. Then I hope you can see this. Step two is you select your observation data. Step three, how do you want to display the data? Step four is you select your map layers. And then finally, it walks you through step five where you can view the map. So I don't want to go into too much detail because I know we're short on time. But I just wanted to give you a sneak preview as to what exciting things might be coming up in the Great Lakes project in the next year or two.
Yeah, that's those are all very enticing things. We were sitting here like nodding vigorously, like, yes, we want that to happen as soon as we can.
Yes.
So thank you for sharing that. And hopefully it gets everyone else as excited as we are about it. And it sounds like, though, even just becoming familiar with the capabilities of FieldScope as it is will be very handy moving forward, even once those changes take place.
Exactly. Yes.
Okay. So next up, thanks, Elena, for that, for all of the information you shared. Next up is Elizabeth. She's going to talk a little bit about the other professional development opportunities that are coming up that are connected to FieldScope and otherwise. And let me, I'm going to take our screen back here. Yeah, there we go. Just give me a second to get set up here. Oops. And of course, my screen has gone. All right, there we go. So let me get Elizabeth lined up here. All right, Elizabeth, are you ready?
Ready. Well, first off, I wanted to thank everybody, all of our panelists and our participants and the testimonials. Thank you for participating today and providing even more information for others that are just getting started. That was really helpful. And so, Elena, just like reiterating what Stephanie just said, we're ready to go and we're ready to expand to sort of the next. And I'm so glad that, what seems to be happening is what we would expect from National Geographic, that they don't just launch a tool, but they look at how it can be improved, and so I see that new user interface being really nice. I think it'll really help guide all of our users through the different activities that they want to engage in. So I'm excited about it, and I'm really excited about the data collection app that people can use in the field, because we all know that at least along the Great Lakes shoreline that our connectivity isn't all that great in the field. Sometimes it's just hard to even get a signal, so especially when you're around some of the sand dunes. So we will be scheduling some additional webinars about FieldScope in 2014, but I'd like to offer you all of you the opportunity to try to provide us with feedback about what additional topics would be useful to you. We've gone over the tools, we've gone over some other things, we've had some people speak that have tested things out, but if there are specific topics that you would like us to focus on, please send something in the chat here, ask a question, or send Michigan Sea Grant an email, and we want to respond to that. So I don't have another webinar date for you at this point. But we've got a number of different other things happening both in Michigan and then regionally. So Michigan Sea Grant is always at the Michigan Science Teachers Association Conference. Please come see us at our exhibit table, and we can talk to you a little bit more about FieldScope and some other tools. And we'll be presenting some information that will be focused on using data in the classroom or in the field about dangerous currents. And so that's we're presenting a new lesson about that topic. And then also Brandon Schroeder could add a little bit here about the regional Great Lakes Stewardship Conference, and that's an opportunity as well, and then also the Great Lakes Be Wet. Brandon, would you like to say a word or two about those? Still with us?
Yes, I am. I was on mute.
Okay.
There. Not. I was just saying, we spent a lot of time and energy in providing leadership for the Northeast Michigan Great Lakes Stewardship Initiative Hub. That's one hub or cluster of nine across Michigan that are focused on implementing or supporting place-based stewardship education programming. So my hope is over the course of the year that we can really support our teachers in making a go of using this tool, but also sort of share and spread that opportunity among some of those other place-based education clusters around the state.
Okay, thanks. I know that I heard the regional GLSI conference in Grand Rapids was successful and that people got a lot out of that. So Elena asked specifically if we could do something for the Great Lakes BWET conference, which is scheduled for November 2014, and we'll work on planning something for that. But then, Elena, you had some specific things that you might want to mention as well in terms of, you know, a newsletter coming up and some other things happening in terms of the NSTA conference that I'm sure a lot of people attend from around the region.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're really trying to publicize FieldScope over 2014, especially the new version we have coming out. So I plan on submitting a proposal to NSTA, will be in Richmond in 2014. I'll also be at a lot of state environmental ed conferences in the Chesapeake Bay region. I'll be presenting at NAAEE, which I think is in Canada. That's the North American Association for Environmental Education, is in Canada in 2014. I'm sure a lot of other opportunities that are slipping my mind at the moment. But yeah, we're definitely trying to get the word out there. As was just mentioned, we do have a newsletter that we're going to start publishing, and it'll probably come out 4 times a year. And the newsletter will be able to announce new developments in FieldScope, because things are changing so quickly with FieldScope. New developments in FieldScope featuring new projects and featuring teachers and how they're using it in the classroom, and also featuring nonprofit organizations and how they're using FieldScope as well.
Thanks, Elena. And I just wanted to encourage all of you to keep exploring, you know, the FieldScope tools, both Chesapeake and the Great Lakes one. And it's nice to compare and contrast, you know, what we've got between the two. So look for those opportunities coming up. And then I'll turn it over to Stephanie, who's got another poll, it looks like.
Yes, just closed it out. So hopefully you guys got a chance to vote. And it was essentially just asking if you'd like more webinars on FieldScope. It looks like pretty overwhelmingly yes and or maybe. So we'll leave that at that. And then I wanted to kind of wrap things up. Again, I know we just did a poll, but I'm going to do another one. Just to kind of compare the results from before. I'm just wondering if you guys have a better sense of what FieldScope is all about now that we've done 2 sessions and went a little more in depth and covered a couple of, you know, covered some things more in depth and covered some questions, some first person testimonials, things like that. Also, while you're doing that, I just want you to keep in mind that we're here to answer your questions. So feel free to reach out to us via email, phone, whatever's easier for you. Give us feedback. Let us know what's going on. If you have any remaining questions, I know we had one come in from Matthew Upton about importing satellite data into FieldScope as a separate layer or overlayer, and a couple of specifics from him. So like sea surface temperature data for the Great Lakes area and beyond, or LIDAR data for terrestrial uses. And that's something that I'm going to put into our feedback document, and we'll continually go through things and review them. We'll work with Elena and National Geographic to see if we can make this the most usable tool possible for everyone. And with that, I'd also like to say that the more people who participate, the richer the experience for everyone. So please enter your observations, try it out, use it in the classroom. Let us know what works, what doesn't. You know, as always, the feedback loop is open. And if you want to stay up to date on things that we're doing with FieldScope as well as other Sea Grant initiatives, make sure you sign up for our newsletter or follow us on Twitter or Facebook. Or again, just reach out to us and say, hey, what's going on? And we will be in touch on things like that. So as we wrap up, once you close out of the webinar, a little quick survey is going to pop up. I think it's 7 or 8 questions. If you would just take a few minutes to fill it out, I don't even think it'll take you a few minutes. But we just want to make sure that we're hitting the mark with what we're doing. So if you want to take a look at that, provide us some feedback, that would be fantastic. Doesn't look like there, let's see. Nope, doesn't look like any further questions. So thanks again, guys, for participating. I think that this has been, I know I've learned a lot just by watching Alina and hearing some of the responses from Elizabeth. So I can imagine that it's been pretty informative, or I hope it's been pretty informative for everyone. So thanks again for participating. Let us know if you have questions and have a good afternoon.
All right. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks. Goodbye.